رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفاه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وبعد Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of Gardens of the Pious. In this series, we explain the ahadith of the marvelous book of Riyadh al-Salihin by Imam al-Nawawi, may Allah have mercy on him. That is the second episode in the book of truthfulness or as-sidq, and it is the 34th episode in this series. And today, inshallah, we'll begin with the 57th hadith. Before that, I would like to remind you with our phone numbers, beginning with the area code 00202-3855-248-249. And the email address is gardens@huda.tv. I also receive the emails right away during the program if you don't have access to call in, inshallah. The 57th hadith in this chapter is narrated by a great companion who is known as Sahl ibn Hunayf. May Allah be pleased with him. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من سأل الله تعالى الشهادة بصدق بلغه منازل الشهداء وإن مات على فراشه رواه مسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in this hadith, which is collected by Imam Muslim, it's a sound hadith and narrated by the great companion Sahl ibn Hunayf, may Allah be pleased with him, that he who asks Allah for ash-shahada, which is martyrdom, bi-sidqin, sincerely, while he is true in his intention, he really desires to die as a shaheed, then Allah will raise him to the high status of ash-shuhada, even if he happened to die on his bed. Al-Shahada is one of the very high ranks which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants only selected servants of his. And he has promised a magnificent reward for Al-Shuhada in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In ayah number 69 of Surah An-Nisa, Allah the Almighty says, وَمَن يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِم مِّنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. This ayah was revealed when some of the companions were so worried that if he dies, he wouldn't get to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that often in paradise, as he, whenever in the dunya he desires to see him, he just goes to the masjid. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah, confirming the fact that if you would like to be in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then obey Allah and obey the Messenger of Allah. So he stated that, and whoever obeys Allah and the Messenger of Allah, then he will be in the company of وَمَنْ يُطَعِ اللَّهَ رَسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ, in the company of those whom Allah bestowed his blessings upon them, of the prophets and الصديقين, the truthful ones, and الشهداء, the martyrs, والصالحين, and the righteous ones, and how excellent will be such company. Okay. So the rank of ash-shuhada is stated right after an-nabiyyin was-siddiqeen. The hadith which we have combines these two levels. As-siddiqeen was-shuhada. He who asks Allah the Almighty for martyrdom truthfully with sincere intention, he shall be granted the honor of ash-shahada even if he does not die on a battlefield, even if he dies on his bed. Why? Because he was so in his intention. He was sincere, he was truthful. And who knows about that? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sahl ibn Hunayf, the narrator of this hadith, is one of the great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He attended all the battles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's an Ansari. يعني, he was one of the original dwellers of Al-Madinah who received the immigrants, supported them, and they granted them the financial support as well, the moral support. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam established what is known as Al-Ukhuwa, the brotherhood between each one of Al-Muhajirin, the immigrants, and another of Al-Ansar, the supporters, to share with him his house, to support him financially. And we knew how much Al-Ansar supported Al-Muhajirin, and that's why they were praiseworthy in the Quran. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I was not one of Al-Muhajirin, I would have loved to be one of Al-Ansar. And he said, whichever path or way that Al-Ansar will follow, I will follow them. And he admired Al-Ansar, the supporters. So Suhail, Sahl ibn Hunayf, may Allah be pleased with him, the narrator of the hadith, was one of Al-Ansar. So when we say that he attended all the battles with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what an honor. But normally it is mentioned in his biography as Sahl ibn Hunayf al-Badri. Al-Badri is like, this is what is known in Arabic grammar as an-Nisbah, to attribute somebody to a city, to a place, to a trait, like Makki, he is from Mecca. Ansari, he is one of Al-Ansar. Madani, Pakistani, he is from Pakistan. Badri, he attended the Battle of Badr, and what an honor. Even though I mentioned in the beginning that he attended al-mashahida kullaha ma'an nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he attended all the battles and the expeditions with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what an honor. Yet, you will always find the word al-Badri for any of the 314 companions who happened to witness the Battle of Badr with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? This battle was the greatest battle, because it was the very first battle which distinguished between the truth and falsehood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked at those companions who were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on this battle, and he supported them with victory, as you all know, over 1,000 mushrik. And he said, do as you wish, I have forgiven you all your sins. And that's why when Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a was involved in an error during the conquest of Mecca, when he sent a hint with a woman to the Meccan chiefs to inform them that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is planning on conquering Mecca, and Allah revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this incident, and he was caught. Umar ibn Khattab wanted to kill Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Nay, Umar." He said, he is a munafiq. He said, how do you know Allah has forgiven all the sins of those who have attended the Battle of Badr? إن الله اطلع على أهل بدر فقال افعلوا ما شئتم فقد غفرت لكم. So the honor of attending the Battle of Badr is the ultimate honor. So whenever a companion is listed amongst Al-Badriyin, that's it. Because he's been praised by Allah in the Quran and by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah promises that these guys are forgiven, which is a great glad tiding. A very important information that not many of us know, that when we say that آخر نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بين المهاجرين والأنصار. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم established the brotherhood between one of المهاجرين and one of الأنصار. Who was the intimate brother of this companion, سهل بن حنيف. سهل بن حنيف الأنصاري. Who was the Muslim مهاجر whom the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made him a brother to سهل بن حنيف. That was أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه. That's another great honor. And that's why when Sahl ibn Hunayf died, he died in Al-Kufa. He moved to Al-Kufa in Iraq during the era of Khilafat Ali ibn Abi Talib. May Allah be pleased with him. And he died on the year 38 after the immigration. And Ali ibn Abi Talib led his funeral prayer. And he felt very sorry for his death. And he prayed for him, as did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his life, prayed for him. Why? Because on the Battle of Uhud, when, as you know, that most of the companions dispersed away and they ran off from the battlefield, Sahl ibn Hunayf, may Allah be pleased with him, was one of the very few who adhered to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to defend him, and he was a very great archer. So the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed for him and said to the companions who were around him, "Anbilu sahlan." فَإِنَّهُ سَهْلٌ. Give him the arrows, he's easy, يعني. He can handle this easily. He can target the enemies easily. And he's سهل. By the word سهل means easy. And this is a good sign, because as Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy on him, says, الْأَسْمَاءُ أَوْعِيَةٌ لِمُسَمَّيَاتِهَا. The names reflect the traits and the behavior and the nature of those who have such names. So when somebody is named Sahl, then he's Sahl, he's easy. When somebody is named Saab or Hajar or Harsh or a rock, you'll find his behavior likewise. His nature will be according to his name or her name. So in any case, Sahl ibn Hunayf was one of the great companions. The Prophet ﷺ prayed for him, and Ali ibn Abi Talib led his funeral prayer. May Allah be pleased with him. Sahl ibn Hunayf once was in Al-Kufa and he saw a funeral of a Jew. So he got up, he stood up. So he was told, he's a Jew. He said, so, isn't it a soul? I have witnessed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing the same. So because this is a funeral or somebody has died, regardless whether he's a Muslim or a non-Muslim, he got up as a respect to the soul of the human being. May Allah be pleased with him. And the hadith is collected by Imam Muslim. Now with our interesting hadith, which is also collected by Imam Muslim, من سأل الله تعالى الشهادة بصدق بلغه الله منازل الشهداء وإن مات على فراشه. الشهادة has many varieties or martyrdom. It is not only to die on the battle field while fighting the enemies or to die defending the borders or no, it's much broader than that. That's why Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, ما تعدون الشهيد فيكم, whom do you consider as a martyr? So the companion said, من قتل في سبيل الله فهو شهيد, as they were taught, one who dies for the sake of Allah, يعني on a battlefield, then he is a shaheed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, then the martyrs of my ummah are very few. They're very little. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, then who is considered a martyr? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam began by saying, one who dies for the sake of Allah is a martyr. One who dies as a result of al-ta'un. Al-ta'un is a plague or any contagious disease which kills a mass of people. Al-ta'un is a martyr. And one who dies as a result of an abdomen disease like cancer, renal failure, liver cirrhosis, an abdominal disease which killed him, or a woman, an-nufasa, while she was giving birth or while she was pregnant and she dies as a result of that, while she's a believer, she's a shahida as well. Sometimes when people who do not know much Arabic. They know just a little bit, and they read the word وَالْمَطْعُونُ شَهِيدُ وَالْمَبْطُونُ شَهِيدُ. They interpret the word al-mat'oon as the person who had been stabbed from al-ta'an, which is wrong. Al-mat'oon in this hadith means the person who died as a result of al-ta'oon, which is the plague. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He broadened the area of al-shahada or martyrdom to cover those who suffer of anything, and they die patiently, expecting and anticipating the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not objecting to His decree, not condemning the destiny which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained for them. Also, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another hadith, مَنْ مَاتَ دُونَ دَمِهِ فَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ وَمَنْ مَاتَ دُونَ مَالِهِ فَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ وَمَنْ مَاتَ دُونَ أَهْلِهِ فَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. There is another variety of al-shuhada, the martyrs. One who dies defending himself is a martyr. One who dies defending his wealth is a martyr. One who dies while defending his family members is a martyr. So if somebody, a gang or a criminal, stuck you up and asked you for your money and you refused, and he defended yourself and he stabbed you or he killed you or you shot you as a result of that, this is a shahada. But it requires some wisdom. If you think and you assume that you can ward off that person, like if you're well trained, no problem, you may try. But if the guy has a weapon that kills, a pistol, a machine gun, a machete, and you're not armed the least, and you know that taking your life is a piece of cake, then I wouldn't suggest so, because it would be simply wasting your life for nothing. Okay? But if you're capable to defend yourself, and that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered a similar question when somebody said, Ya Rasulullah, what should I do if somebody asks me for my money? Like he's using a weapon, sticking me up, and he's trying to rob me. What should I do? He said, لا تعطيه مالك. Don't give him your money. Under the edge of a sword, or he's pointing the muzzle of his gun towards me and said, give me your wallet. He said, don't give him your money. He said, what should I do? He said, fight against him. He said, what if I killed him? He said, he will be in hell. He said, what if he killed me? He said, you will be in heaven. This is a type of shahada. If you're defending yourself, you're defending your wealth, this is entirely different than fighting over a worldly thing and both of you claim the same right. Then النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا التقى المسلمان بسيفيهما فالقاتل والمقتول في النار. If two Muslims fight against each other, face and confront each other with their swords or their weapons, a weapon that may kill, so one of them kill the other, then both would be doomed to hell, the murderer and the murdered one. They asked him, Ya Rasulullah, it is expected that the murderer should go to hell. What about the murdered one? He said, he too was keen to kill his opponent, who happened to be his Muslim brother. We're fighting over a holy thing, but I'm defending my right. I'm defending myself against a transgressor. That's a different case. Against a woman is defending herself against a rapist. A man is defending himself or his family against somebody or people who are trying to rob him or his family or hurt him or his family. That's a different case, because there is a transgressor and there is an oppressed one. So I hope this issue is very clear. Shaddad ibn al-Had narrated that once a Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَآمَنَ بِهِ وَاتَّبَعَهُ. He accepted Islam and he followed him. Then he agreed to immigrate with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised the companions to take good care of him. He's a Bedouin, he needs somebody to walk him through and to teach him and so on. Then in one of the battles after the Hijrah, they actually defeated the enemies and there was war spoils. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divided the spoils and he sent a share to this Bedouin. Can you imagine? We don't even know his name, but we know his status at least. Why? Because of what he did. And this is what matters the most. So this guy said, what is this? They said, the Prophet ﷺ sent you your share of the world's spoils. He said, okay. Then he took whatever they gave him and he went to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulallah, what is this? He said, that's your share of the world's spoils. You participated in the battle. So Nabi, the Bedouin said to the Prophet ﷺ, said, well, ما على هذا بايعتك? I did not follow you nor give you the pledge of allegiance to get some worldly share of the world's spoils. He said, so what do you want? He said, rather I gave you the pledge of allegiance so that I can fight for the sake of Allah, and I get killed by an arrow in my throat and I enter Al-Jannah. Wait a minute, before you just read the text as is, then you say this is what all Muslims are looking for, to get killed so that they can go to Al-Jannah. No, basically the companion wants to enter paradise through defending his faith, through defending his religion. But if there is no war, if there is no need to fight, if there is no need to participate in jihad, Islam basically calls every person to peace, beginning with Muslims, then extend it to non-Muslims, neighbors and otherwise. فَإِنْ جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَاجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. As long as non-Muslims do not wage a war against us, then you should resort to peace as well. But we're talking about a particular incident where the ultimatum was to be on a battlefield. So he doesn't want any worldly share. Rather, he wanted to be martyred, to enter paradise as a result of that. Because the Quran talked a lot about al-shahada and martyrdom. ألا تحسبن الذين قتلوا في سبيل الله أمواتا بل أحياء عند ربهم يرزقون. Don't you think that those who got killed for Allah's sake are dead? Rather, they are alive with the Lord being provided. ولا تقولوا لمن يقتل في سبيل الله أموات. And don't you call those who have been killed for the sake of Allah or for Allah's cause in jihad on a battlefield, on a legitimate war, they're dead. Rather, they are living, and so on. These are ayat, some ayat are talking about that, which we went through them many times before. So he said, this is what I expected. He said, إِن تَصْدُقِ اللَّهَ يَصْدُقْ. Well, if you're true in your intention, if you really mean it, then Allah will deliver. Allah will fulfill your wish and your desire. SubhanAllah, soon after that, they had to face the enemies once again on the battlefield. Then a short while later, they brought this Bedouin to the Prophet ﷺ. He had been killed, he had been martyred. And Nabi ﷺ said, is it him? He said, yes. And he looked, he got hit by an arrow in his throat in the same place where he pointed at, and he said, this is what I give you the pledge of allegiance for. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commented on that by saying, صَدَقَ اللَّهَ فَصَدَقَ. He was so in his intention, in his promise, in what he wanted and anticipated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivered to him whatever he desired, whatever he wanted, which means he definitely got the honor, and he was granted the honor of the martyrdom or a shahada. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, صَدَقَ اللَّهَ فَصَدَقَهُ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took off his outer garment, his jubba, and he wrapped him in his own jubba or outer garment as a coffin. Then the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the funeral prayer for him, and he said, اللَّهُمَّ هَذَا عَبْدُكَ خَرَجَ مُهَاجِرًا فِي سَبِيلِكَ فَقُتِلَ شَهِيدًا أَنَا شَهِيدٌ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. Oh Allah, this is your servant. He got off his house migrating for your sake, and he got killed as a martyr for your sake. I bear witness, I testify that he died as a shaheed. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We'll take a short break and we'll be back inshallah. Please stay tuned.
Allah, رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. A quick reminder with our phone numbers beginning with area code 002-0238-555-248-249. And the email address is gardens@huda.tv. Talking about being truthful in your intention, in what you desire, in what you're asking for, because a lot of people actually claim things and they keep talking about it, but inside is something different. We find that, especially with regards to the hadith we just studied before the break, من سأل الله تعالى الشهادة بصدق بلغه الله منازل الشهداء ولو مات على فراشه. خالد بن الوليد, may Allah be pleased with him, he attended literally hundreds of battles. He was a great warrior. And subhanAllah, there was not a single spot in his body which did not have an injury, either a stab of a sword or a knife or a hit of an arrow or a spear. His body was all injured and scars all over his body. SubhanAllah, he did not die on the battlefield. Rather, at the time of his death, he was lying down on his bed and said, by Allah, there is not a single spot in my body, but it has an injury of a sword, a spear, or an arrow. And yet, there I am. I'm dying on my bed like a camel. فَلَا نَامَتْ أَعْيُنُ الْجُبَنَاءِ. He was sending a message to the coward ones. Then don't be afraid of death, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أينما تكونوا يدرككم الموت ولو كنتم في بروج مشيدة. Wheresoever you are, wheresoever you be, death will reach you. Even if you're taking a shelter in بروج مشيدة, in lofty towers. If you're hiding in a skyscraper, because it's all in Allah's universe. Angel of death knows your address. كل نفس ذائقة الموت. So Khalid ibn al-Walid attended many, many battles, being injured so many times, yet he did not die in the battlefield. He died on his bed. فَلَا نَامَتْ أَعْيُنُ الْجُبَنَاءِ. So if you are destined to die on a battlefield, you will die on a battlefield. You're destined to die on your bed, and at whatever time you will die, only whenever your fixed term has come. That gives the believer an assurance not to fear anything, to be courageous, not to fear but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of my students, whom I posted his picture and his story on my Facebook page, and he's still there. And also, I'm proud to consider him a good friend. May Allah have mercy on him. He was very active in da'wah and in seeking knowledge. He's an engineer coming from a very rich family, running his daddy's factory, driving one of the finest cars. Yet, he spent a great portion of his time arranging for da'wah meeting, receiving people from the airport, especially new Muslims, passing on flyers to non-Muslims in tourism places and so on in Cairo. On the day of the massacre, which happened a couple of weeks ago in Egypt, he saw what is happening and how people were dying right and left, and men and women and children. So he was at home. Once he saw the news, he rushed with his car to assist those who have been injured. While he was assisting others, a sniper from the army forces shot him in his eye, and the bullet went through his brain. He was in coma for 23 days until he just died last Friday. May Allah have mercy on him. I know him and many others. I know many of those whom, alhamdulillah, Allah granted them the honor of ash-shahada. They have been longing for it. They have been asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these guys did not ask for a shahada because they were poor or could not find a job, could not get married. No, they were very wealthy. They had their own businesses. They were highly educated. They were very active in da'wah. And that's why they were inspired that a shahada is the ultimate goal. They did not fight. They did not lift a finger. They did not pose a gun to any person. Rather, they were assisting and helping those who had been injured, and they got shot. This is somebody whom a shahada was written for him, even though he was lying down on his bed in the comfort of his house, then he was called for it. So it's a matter of Allah's choice, Allah's call. This is exactly like Hajj. There is 1.5, 1.6 billion Muslims worldwide. I believe that vast majority of them are dying to perform Hajj. But there are only a couple million people who get to perform Hajj every year. Do they perform Hajj simply because they're wealthy and they can afford it and they can buy a package in this company or this travel agency? No. They perform Hajj, this very few number, 2 million, 3 million compared to 1.6 million, or a billion, I'm sorry, simply because they have been invited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have been carefully and divinely chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows who is very true and very sincere in his intention and who deserves to visit his house. Who deserves the honor of a shahada. And the honor of a shahada or martyrdom isn't just limited to the person who got martyred. La, nay. Rather, it expands to cover his family members, his 70 family members, to be eligible for his intercession, to take them from fire, to take them to Al-Jannah because of the honor, because the person gave away his life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why when we hear the statements of those who lost their children, whether in Syria and recently in Egypt and in Palestine, these guys are very proud. A woman, and this interview was on one TV channel, the host was discussing with her that if we rewind the tape and we go back, would you still allow your son to be a part of this and expose him to getting killed? She said, please, don't say that he got killed. Rather, he was martyred. He said, I'm sorry, I mean that. She said, yes. And as a matter of fact, if I still have a chance, if he's still alive, I will send him again. And I would send all my sons. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants this honor only to selected people, not to everyone. What I'm trying to say is a lot of people claim things, but they're not up to it. They're not up to what they claim. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows who is very sincere in his intention. He gives him this honor. The following hadith, and I hope that we can cover this hadith in this segment. That is the 59th hadith in the whole series, and it is the 5th hadith in the book of truthfulness. أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I want you to bear with me. It's kind of a long hadith, but it is very interesting. غزا نبي من الأنبياء صلوات الله وسلامه عليهم فقال لقومه لا يتبعني رجل ملك بضع امرأة وهو يريد أن يبني بها ولما يبني بها ولا أحد بنى بيوتا لم يرفع سقوفها ولا أحد اشترى غنما أو خليفات وهو ينتظر أولادها فغزى فدنا من القرية صلاة العصر أو قريبا من ذلك فقال للشمس إنك مأمورة وأنا مأمور اللهم احبسها علينا فحبست حتى فتح الله عليه فجمع الغنائم فجاءت يعني النار لتأكلها فلم تطعمها
فقال إن فيكم غلولا. فقال إن فيكم غلولا. أو فقال صلى الله the prophet of this of those people. فقال إن فيكم غلولا فليبايعني من كل قبيلة الرجل. فلزقت يد رجل بيده فقال فيكم الغلول. فليبايعني قبيلتك. فلزقت يد رجلين أو ثلاثة بيده فقال فيكم الغلول. فجاءوا برأس مثل رأس بقرة من الذهب فوضعها فجاءت النار فأكلتها فلم تحل الغنائم لأحد قبلنا. ثم أحل الله لنا الغنائم لما رأى ضعفنا وعجزنا فأحلها لنا. متفق عليه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said there was a prophet from amongst the nations before us who waged a war, an expedition. Ghaza, ghazwa is an expedition. So he said to his people that who should follow me and who should not. He said anyone who has married a woman and wants to consummate the marriage or has married and did not consummate the marriage yet should not follow me. And also a man who has built a house but has not completed its roof should not follow me. Nor a man who has sheep or she camels and is waiting for the birth of their young ones, he too should not follow me. So the Prophet carried out the expedition, and when he reached the town at the time, or nearly at the time of Asr prayer, he said to the son, O son, you're under Allah's order, and I'm under Allah's order too. O Allah, stop it. Yani, stop the son from sitting. The son was stopped till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him victorious. Then he collected the war spoils, and the fire came to burn it, but it did not burn it. He said to his men, some of you have stolen something from the spoils. So one man from every tribe should give me a pledge of allegiance by shaking hands with me. They did so. And the hand of a man got stuck over the hand of the Prophet. Then the Prophet, peace be upon him, said to that man, the theft has been committed by one of your people. So all the persons of your tribe should give me the pledge of allegiance by shaking hands with me. Then as a result of that, the hands of two or three men got stuck over the hand of the Prophet, and he said, you've committed the theft. They admitted, and then they brought the head of a goat like the head of a cow, and they put it there. Then the fire came and consumed the spoils. The Prophet added, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw our weakness and disability. So he made the war spoils legal for us. This hadith is agreed upon its authenticity. Before I acknowledge into explaining the hadith, I'd like to give you the meaning of some very important vocabulary which will help us to comprehend the general meaning of the hadith. Ghazwa is an expedition. Ghaza, yani, he was involved or prepared for an expedition. It is in the past tense. The Prophet ﷺ is telling us about a prophet from the prophets before him who prepared for an expedition. The term malaka bud'a imra'atin, yani, married a woman. And he possessed the right to have sexual relations with her. Yet, وَلَمْ يَبْنِ بِهَا, he did not consummate the marriage yet. That's why in the hadith the Prophet ﷺ said, وَإِنَّ فِي بُضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ أَجْرًا. The word بُضْع is a very polite metaphor that refers to the female genitals. So Nabi ﷺ says in the hadith that for having an intimate or a sexual relation with your spouse, and he expressed about this whole sentence, which could be explicit or revealing, by saying, وَإِنَّ فِي بُضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ أَجْرًا. They said, Ya Rasulullah, when he said that for having an intimate relationship with your spouse, you will be rewarded. The hadith, you know it. They said, how could we satisfy our desire and still receive a reward? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what if he does it in haram? Shouldn't he be punished? They said, sure. He said, accordingly, by abstaining from the haram and resorting to the halal, Allah will give him the reward. So the catch is in the word al-budu'a. In another word, al-farj. And al-farj refers to the private part of both men and women. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. Command the believing men to lower their gaze and guard their chastity. And command the believing women to lower their gaze or some of their gaze and to guard their chastity. وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ plural of farj. It's for both men and women. Okay, the following word is الخليفات, plural of خليفة. So the kha is with zabar, the lam is with zair. Al-khalifat, plural of khalifa, which means a pregnant she-camel. A pregnant she-camel. Al-ghulul is dishonesty.
وَمَنْ يَغْلُلْ يَأْتِ بِمَا غَلَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ.
Al-ghulul particularly is stealing from the fund of the public. So taking from the spoils of the war before its distribution is stealing from the whole community, which is the worst case scenario, the worst type of stealing. Stealing from one person is evil, but stealing from the property which belongs to the community is even worse, because each member of the community, each citizen, has a share in it. So required to answer for all of that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَغْلُلْ يَأْتِ بِمَا غَلَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever steals shall come on the day of judgment with whatever he stole. In the hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever stole a sheep, he shall come on the day of judgment carrying the sheep over his shoulders, roaring. A camel, he will be carrying the camel. A car, a train, he will be carrying whatever item that he stole in this dunya. What a scandal. What a shame. In front of everybody. وَمَنْ يَغْلُلْ يَأْتِ بِمَا غَلَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. What does this hadith talk about? النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, in this hadith which Imam al-Nawawi put it in the chapter of As-Sidq for a reason. After we explain it, you'll figure out the reason on your own. Otherwise, we'll discuss it. That during the nations before us, there was jihad. As the Quran talked about Prophet David, Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, when he killed Jalut during the war between Talut and Jalut. So al-jihad is prescribed even in the nations before Islam amongst Bani Israel. And even before that, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the believers to ward off the disbelievers, the good towards the bad, and so on, to maintain peace and to eliminate mischief on earth. So this prophet said to his people, who was about to fight for the sake of Allah, the enemies. We don't know the name of the prophet, but he was one of the prophets of Allah, way before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whoever is following me should not have any worldly attachment in his heart, such as a man who got married but did not consummate the marriage yet. Because he will be on the roads on the battlefield thinking about his brides. No, I don't need to be distracted. And a man who built a house and did not complete it yet, his heart is attached with the dunya. Stay there. And also, a person who happened to purchase khalifat or sheep and expecting them to give birth, his mind is preoccupied with the dunya. This is, of course, in a particular type of jihad, which is known as jihad al-talab. When we're going out to fight the enemies outside our society versus if they attack us in our society. In this case, everybody should drop everything in their hands. Men and women, they should go out without seeking a permit of any person to defend their soil, their faith, and their belief. You find that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, there should not be a prayer while the food has been served, or while the person is resisting the urge of answering the call of nature. لا صلاة بحضرة طعام ولا وهو يدافع الأخبثين. Why? Because if you pray while the food is hot and it smells great and your saliva is going all over, you're not focused in your prayer. Similarly, if you're praying while you have the urge to go to the bathroom, you only focus on one thing. When would you finish so that you can rush like a bullet to the bathroom, to urinate or otherwise? No, when you're involved in the ibadah, your mind should be entirely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly on the battlefield. So this is called sidq. You have to be true in your intention, what you're doing. You have to be focused, you have to be honest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm praying, I'm doing jihad. Detach the dunya from your heart. Then, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us about this prophet when he approached the enemies. It was already Asr time and the sun was about to set. Afterward, there is only very little time to accomplish his victory. So he addressed the sun and he said, "You are being commanded by Allah, me too. Oh Allah, withhold the sun. Let not the sun set until we finish our business." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala withheld the sun by his command. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرٍ لَهَا ذَلِكَ تَقَدِيرُ الْعَزِيزِ الْعَلِيمِ. The sun is one of the servants of Allah. It runs on to a term that has been preordained for it by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Allah says stop, it will stop. One day Allah, by the end of time, you shouldn't rise anymore from the east. You should rather rise from the west. It would do so by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it stopped until he was granted victory. Then afterward, at the time of collecting the spoils, they used not to take it nor distribute it. It has been only made lawful for the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Amongst five privileges were given to the Prophet and were not given to any prophet or any nation before us. He found that somebody have committed theft and stole a golden head of a cow. But he doesn't know whom. So he started taking the pledge of allegiance from people until the hand of the thieves got stuck over his hand. They admitted their sin and they brought it to the Prophet. So he put it back with the spoils and the fire came and it devoured the whole spoils. That was the tradition of what used to happen with regards to the war spoils before Islam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah have mercy on us because he saw our weakness and the love to the dunya. And he made the war spoils lawful for us to distribute. And he does not send the fire to devour it anymore. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have been given five qualities or privileges that no prophet have been given or nation have been given before me. One of them is وَأُحِلَّتْ لِيَ الْغَنَائِمُ. One of them that the Prophet ﷺ is a universal prophet. One of them that the ummah can attend the prayer anywhere on earth as long as it is tahir. And his message ﷺ is universal. So وَأُحِلَّتْ لِيَ الْغَنَائِمُ means the war spoils or the war booty have been made lawful for us to take and distribute amongst us. But no one should take even a shamla, a scarf, or a blanket, or any item, even if it is insignificant, before the distribution of the war spoils. By that, brothers and sisters, we come to the end of the 34th episode of Gardens of the Pious. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst the pious ones and make us eligible to enter the gardens of the pious. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory. To him, he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory. To him, he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.